Tonight in the Albert Hall, it's performed by an all-star cast with the BBC Concert Orchestra, conducted by Barry Wordsworth.
Pity on our passion, we implore you.
These gentlemen must make the choice before you. In the meantime, we tacitly ignore you. When they have chosen two, the battle leaves you plenty. 2 dozen we, and ye are 24.
Till then, enjoy your dolce far niente.
With pleasure. Di contraddiscente. For the merriest members of me. world's here. With nothing and laughing and quipping and laughing, we're happy as happy can be. With nothing and laughing and quipping and laughing, we're happy as happy can be.
We'll call Gondolieri. but that's our Gabby, it's quite on our early, the day that we fly. For gallantry noted, since we were short-coated, if you did devoted, just let me at last. When morning is breaking, our cause is forsaking, to greet their awaking, with carols we come. But summer is mooning, when we're in our mooning,
achieved a capture. This is Tessa.
Rapture.
To me, Janetta fate has granted. Just the very girl I wanted.
Just the very girl you wanted.
If you'd rather change.
My goodness. This indeed is simple rudeness.
I've no preference whatever.
Listen to him. Well, I've and hold us tightly. You have luck extraordinary. We might have been unsightly. If we judge your conduct rightly, 'twas a choice involuntary. Still we thank you most politely, gay and gallant gondolieri.
So we, Marco and Giuseppe, have chosen our brides.
Giannetta and Tessa.
With a rather haphazard method of blind man's buff.
But with the help of a little bit of cheating, just to make sure we get the ones we really want.
Everything's great. And then in walks the Duca Plaza Toro with his whole retinue. Which is only four people because, well, he's a wee bit hard up.
Spanish war, the Duke of Plaza Tor,
and his Grace's Duchess True,
and his Grace's daughter too,
and his Grace's private throng to Venetia's shores have come, to Venetia's shores have come. And
neither that grandee from the Spanish shore, the noble Duke of Plaza Tor,
nor his Grace's Duchess staunch and true.
You may add his Grace's daughter too.
His Grace's own particular drum to Venetia's shores will come, to Venetia's shores will come.
Enterprise of martial kind, when there was any fighting, he led his regiment from behind. He found it less exciting. But when away his regiment ran, his place was at the foro. That celebrated, cultivated, underrated nobleman, the Duke of Plaza Toro.
In the first and foremost flight, you always found that knight. That celebrated, cultivated, underrated nobleman, the Duke of Plaza Toro.
When to evade destruction's hand to hide, they all proceeded. No soldier in that gallant band hid half as well as he did. He lay concealed throughout the war, and so preserved his Doro. That unaffected, undetected, well-connected warrior, the Duke of Plaza Toro.
In every doubt he did, he always took the lead. That unaffected, undetected, well-connected warrior, the Duke of Plaza Toro.
when told that they would all be shot unless they led her service. That hero hesitated, not so marvelous his nervous. He sent his resignation in the first of all his toro. That very knowing, overflowing, easygoing, ballading the Duke of Lazzatoro.
To men of gross acclaim, he always showed the way. That very knowing, overflowing, easygoing, ballading the Duke of Lazzatoro. That very knowing, overflowing, easygoing, ballading the Duke of Lazzatoro.
This is where the plot thickens. Casilda, our daughter, was married when she was a baby to the infant son of the King of Barataria. Now, that prince was whisked off to Venice when he was a child and brought up as a gondolier. So, Casilda is now the Queen of Barataria, and we, the Duke...
And the Duchess, who doesn't like to be left out of anything, have come to Venice to find our daughter's husband, the new King of Barataria.
What neither of them know is that we, Louis and Casilda, are secretly in love.
But of course our relationship is hopeless. Now we realise Casilda is already married.
There was a time forever gone. Ah, woe is me. It was no crime to love but thee alone. Ah, woe is me. One heart, one life, one soul, one aim, one goal. Each in the other's thrall, each all in all. Ah, woe is me.
Don Alhambra is the Grand Inquisitor of Spain. He took the infant prince of Barataria, brought him to Venice, and had him farmed out to a gondolier. The problem a few years down the road is that nobody's exactly certain as to who the prince is. It's a bit embarrassing for everybody.
I stole the prince and I brought him here and left him gaily prattling with a highly respectable gondolier who promised the royal babe to rear and teach him the trade of a timoneer with his own beloved prattling. Both of the babes were strong and stout, and considering all things clever, of that there is no manner of doubt, no probable possible shadow of doubt, no possible doubt whatever.
No possible doubt whatever.
But knowing I'm much disposed to fear to his terrible taste for tippling, that highly respectable gondolier could never declare with a mind sincere which of the two was his offspring dear and which the royal stripling. Which was which he could never make out, despite his best endeavor. Of that there is no manner of doubt, no probable possible shadow of doubt, no possible doubt whatever.
No possible doubt whatever.
Time sped, and when at the end of a year I sought that infant cherished, that highly respectable gondolier was lying a corpse on his humble bier, I dropped a grand inquisitor's tear. That gondolier had perished. A taste for drink combined with gout had doubled him up forever. Of that there is no manner of doubt, no probable possible shadow of doubt, no possible doubt whatever.
No possible doubt whatever.
The children followed his old career. This statement can't be parried. Of a highly respectable gondolier, well, one of the two who will soon here. But which of the two it is not quite clear is the royal prince you married. Search in and out and round about, and you'll discover never a tale so free from every doubt, a probable possible shadow of doubt, a possible doubt whatever.
A tale so free from every doubt, a probable possible shadow of doubt, a possible doubt whatever.
Frequently occur. Life is one closely complicated tangle. Death is the only true unravel.
Try we like long, we can never straighten out life's tangle. Should we in vain endeavor, guess and guess and guess again?
Life's a pudding full of plums.
There's a canker that we numb.
Life's a pudding full of plums. There's a canker that we numb. Wherefore waste our effusion on impossible solutions? Life's a pleasant institution. Let us take it as it comes. Let us take it.
Life's perhaps the only riddle that we shrink from giving up. Life's perhaps the only riddle that we shrink from giving up. Then take it as it comes, take it as it comes. Take the life in we shall stop.
At this point, a wedding procession arrives. If your idea of catching a man is within a game of blind man's buff, you don't want to hang around.
So Tessa and I have already married our two gondoliers.
Yeah.
Everybody's having a great time celebrating, but, of course, Don Alhambra can be a little bit of a killjoy. He appears and says, well, we think that the king is going to be one or other of the gondoliers, but we're not absolutely certain which at this time. He says, why don't you reign jointly? The gondoliers think that's a terrific idea, but their wives aren't quite so certain, because after just half an hour of married life, they're going to be left behind, because at the court of Barataria, ladies are not admitted.
From those to whom an hour ago we were invited. And from a flowing hope you stem, a look at them, and pause before you dare this blow all uninvited. You men can never understand that heart and hand cannot be separated when we grow old.
Uncalled for grief. Your separation will be very brief. To ascertain which is the king and which the other, to Barataria's court I'll bring his foster mother. Her former nursling to declare she'll be delighted. That settled. Let each happy pair be reunited.
Viva! His argument is strong. Viva! We'll not be parted long. Viva! It will be settled soon. Viva! Then comes the honeymoon. Viva! Viva! Viva!
Then one of us will be a queen and sit on a golden throne, with a crown instead of a hat on a head and diamonds all her own. With a beautiful robe of golden green, I've always understood. I wonder whether she'd wear a feather. I rather think she should.
Oh,
dear, if you ever say I wish to be a regular royal queen,
no half and half of
her, I mean no half and half of me.
But I'm the regular royal queen.
She'll drive about in a carriage and pair with the king on the left-hand side, and a milk-white horse as a matter of course whenever she wants to ride, with beautiful silver shoes to wear upon her dainty feet, with endless stocks of beautiful frocks. And as much as she wants to eat,
oh,
tis the greatest thing I want to be a regular royal queen.
No half and half of bed,
I mean no half and half of bed,
but a regular royal queen.
Whenever ever she condescends to walk, be sure she'll shine at that. With her haughty stare and her nose in the air like a well-born aristocrat. At elegant high society talk, she'll bear away the veil. With her, how do you do? And her, how are you? And I trust I see you well.
Oh, tis marvellous that I want to be a regular royal queen. No harp and harp of fair can be, no harp and harp of fair. I'm a regular, 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 regular royal queen.
A noble lord will scrape and carve and level themselves in two, and open their eyes in blank surprise at whatever she likes to do. And everybody will roundly vow she's fair as flowers in May, and say, how clever, that whatsoever she condescends to say.
Oh, tis the promise that I want to be a regular royal queen. No half and half of fair, I mean no half and half of fair. I'm a right now regular, 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 regular royal queen. Oh, tis a glorious thing I mean to be a regular royal queen. A right now regular queen.
But you'll find I
respect your
Republican
palaces. You'll
find I
respect your
Republican
palaces.
For everyone who feels inclined, suppose we undertake to find congenial with his frame of mind, and all shall equal be.
The Chancellor in his peruke, the Earl, the Marquis, and the Duke, the groom, the butler, and the cook, they all shall equal be.
The aristocrat who banks with goods, the aristocrat who hunts and shoots, the aristocrat who cleans our boots, they all shall equal be.
The noble lord who rules the state, the noble lord who cleans the plate,
the noble lord who scrubs the grate, they all shall equal be.
The lord high bishop orthodox, the lord high coachman on the box,
the lord high vagabond in the stocks, they all shall equal be.
For everyone who feels inclined, suppose they undertake to find congenial with his frame of mind, congenial with his frame of mind, and all shall equal. Sing high, sing low.
Thank you.
to dress a lady less than 45. You'll please to frown on every gown that you may see.
Where they go to the Bunny Island, where they go,
where the Lord and Mother meet.
absolute impunity, who put the subject at their ease by doing all they can to please. And thus to earn their bread and cheese seize every opportunity. And thus to earn their bread and cheese seize every opportunity. Ah, we act in perfect unity. Ah, we act in perfect unity.
So it's 3 months later, and we're having a whale of a time as the kings of Barataria. Only it's kings with a difference.
We've been brought up as good republicans, you see. We don't believe in the monarchy, and the court operates with complete equality.
So equal, in fact, that we end up doing all the work.
Rising early in the morning, we proceed to light the fire. Then our majesty adorning in our workaday attire, we embark without delay on the duties of the day. First we polish off some batches of political dispatches and foreign politicians circumvent. Then if business isn't heavy, we may hold a royal levy or ratify some acts of parliament. Then we probably review the household troops with the usual shallow humps and shallow hoops, or receive with ceremonial and state an interesting Eastern potentate. After that we generally go and dress our private belly. It's a rather nervous duty, he's a touchy little man. Write some letters literary for our private secretary. He's shaking his spelling, so we help him if we can. Then in view of cravings inner, we go down and order dinner. Then we polish the regalia and the coronation plate. Spend an hour in titivating all our gentlemen in waiting, for we run a little errand for the ministers of state. Oh, philosophers may sing of the troubles of a king, yet the duties are delightful and the privilege is great. But the privilege and pleasure that we treasure beyond measure is to run a little errand for the ministers of state.
Oh, philosophers may sing of the troubles of a king, yet the duties are delightful and the privilege is great.
After luncheon, making merry on a abundant glass of sherry, if we've nothing in particular to do, we may make a proclamation or receive a deputation, then we possibly create a peer or two. Then we help our fellow creature on his path with a garter or the thistle or the bath. Or we dress and toddle off in semi-state to a festival, a function, or a fete. Then we go and stand at sentry at the palace private entry, marching thither, up and down, and to and fro, while the warrior on duty goes in search of beer and beauty. And it generally happens that he hasn't far to go. He relieves us, is he able, just in time to lay the table. Then we dine and serve the coffee, and at 12:30 or 1, with a pleasure that's emphatic, we retire to our attic, with a gratifying feeling that our duty has been done. Oh, philosophers may sing of the troubles of a king, but of pleasures there are many and of worries there are none. And the culminating pleasure that we treasure beyond measure is the gratifying feeling that our duty has been done.
Oh, philosophers may sing of the troubles of a king, but of pleasures there are many and of worries there are none. And the culminating pleasure that we treasure beyond measure is the gratifying feeling that our duty has been done.
A king, as I've been told, in the wonder-working days of old, when hearts were twice as good as gold and 20 times as mellow. could pimp a triumph in his face, and in his heart he found a place for all the erring human race. And every wretched fellow, when he had a Rhenish wine to drink, it made him very sad to think that some had junk it, or a jink must be content with toddy.
With toddy, must be content with toddy.
He wished all men as rich as he, and he was rich as rich could be. So to the top of every tree promoted everybody.
Now that's the kind of king for me. He wished all men as rich as he. So to the top of every tree promoted everybody.
Lord chancellors were cheap as sprats, and bishops in their shovel hats were plentiful as tabby cats. In point of fact, too many ambassadors cropped up like hay, prime ministers and such as they grew like asparagus in May, and dukes were three a penny. On every side field marshals in small beer were lords lieutenant deep, with admirals the ocean team all around his white dominions.
Admirals around his white dominions.
And party leaders you might meet in twos and threes in every street, maintaining with no little heat their various opinions.
Now that's a sight you couldn't meet, two party leaders in each street, maintaining with no little heat their various opinions.
That king, although no one denies his heart was of abnormal size, yet he'd have acted otherwise if he had been acuter. The end is easily foretold when every blessed thing you hold is made of silver or of gold. You long for simple pewter when you have nothing else to wear but cloth of gold and satin rare. For cloth of gold you cease to care. Up goes the price of shoddy.
Of shoddy. Up goes the price of shoddy.
In short, whoever you may be, to this conclusion you'll agree. When everyone is somebody, then no one's anybody.
Now that's plain as plain can be, to this conclusion we agree.
When everyone is somebody, then no one's anybody.
So, we have a wonderful existence. The only blot on the landscape is we miss our wives.
And there's only one recipe for a perfect happiness.
Take a pair of sparkling eyes hidden ever and anon in a merciful eclipse. Do not heed them my surprise, having passed the Rubicon. Take a pair of rosy lips. Take a figure trimly planned, such as admiration wets. Be particular in this. Take a tender little hand, fringed with dainty fingerettes. Press it, press it. In parenthesis, if you can, take all these lucky men, take and keep them, if you can, if you can. Take a pretty little coat, quite a miniature affair, hung about with threads fine. Furnish it upon this porch with the treasures rich and rare I've endeavored to define. Live to love and love to live, you will ripen at your ease, growing on the sunny side.
conflict has nothing more to give. You're a dainty man to please if you're not satisfied. Not satisfied. Upon it if you can, take my counsel, happy man, act upon it if you can, if you can. Take my counsel, happy man. Upon it if you can, if you can, if you can. Act upon it if you can, happy man, if you can.
Arriving breathless after 3 months away from our husbands, we want to start the honeymoon we never had.
So naturally enough, the men call for an exhausting dance.
Oh,
Everybody's having just too good a time, so in comes Don Alhambra once more and says that one of the boys is actually married to Casilda.
So that means...
that one of us...
is a bigamist.
The problem will, of course, be sorted out when Louis's mother arrives, as she was the prince's foster mother all those years ago. Until then, a stiff upper lip is called for.
Does that's clear.
And if I can catch her, I'll pinch her and smush her and send her away with a flame of ear.
That young lady married to receive her can be
pure. If I overtake her, I warrant her, make her to shake her aristocratic. If she marry Giuseppe, he will have to part. If I get to do it, I warrant she'll root and teach her to marry the man of my heart. If she marries less than Marco, you're a spinster. No matter, no matter, if I can get at her, I doubt if her mother will know her again. If I have to do it, I warrant her, if I can get at her, I doubt if her mother will know her again. If I have to do it, I warrant her, if I can get at her, I doubt if her mother will know her again.
The Duke and Duchess of Plaza Toro now make a grand entrance. Grander than the last one, in fact, so that their daughter, Casilda, can now take her place as queen.
Touches heart of Duke
and heart of Duchess who resign their pet
with profound regret.
She, a beauty, was a model
when a tiny tittle toddle, and at 21
she's excelled by none.
At 21
she's excelled by none. At 21
she's excelled by none.
She comes to play the royal hand. Your tender places will be troubled for the king who loses good.
Child, I'm completely miserable and I've come under protest because I'm still madly in love with Louis.
I tell her to pull herself together. Just grin and bear it. After all, I married the Duke.
On the day when I was wedded to your admirable sire, I acknowledge that I dreaded an explosion of his ire. I was overcome with panic, for his temper was volcanic, and I didn't dare revolt, for I feared a thunderbolt. I was always very wary, for his fury was ecstatic, his refined vocabulary most unpleasantly emphatic. To the thunder of this tartar, I looked thunder like a martyr. When intently he was fuming, I was gently unassuming. When reviling me completely, I was smiling very sweetly. I was smiling very sweetly, very sweetly. Giving him the very best and getting back the very worst. That is how I tried to tame your great progenitor at first. Giving him the very best and getting back the very worst. That is how I tried to tame the great progenitor at first. But I found that a reliance on my threatening appearance and a resolute defiance of my rightful interference and a gentle intimation of my firm determination to see what I could do to be wife and husband too was the only thing required for to make his temper supple, and you couldn't have desired a more reciprocating couple. Ever willing to be wooing, we were billing, we were cooing. When I nearly from him parted, we were nearly broken hearted. When in sequel reunited, we were equally delighted. We were equally delighted, delighted. So with double shot at guns and colours veiled to the mast, I tamed your insignificant progenitor at last. So with double shot at guns and colours veiled to the mast, I tamed your insignificant
The Duke's fortunes have been restored. He's made himself rich again by forming himself into a limited company and selling his services to those who can pay.
To help unhappy commoners and add to their enjoyment affords a man of noble rank congenial employment. Of our attempts, we offer you examples illustrative. The work is light. And, I may add, it's most remunerative. Tax favors and bonus for newspaper owners I get, and they're highly delighted.
They're highly delighted.
MPs baroneted, sham colonels gazetted, and second-rate composers knighted.
That's knighted.
Now privatization is good for the nation. Share options are liked by directors.
They're liked by directors.
And then there's Lord Simon, a hard one to rhyme on. Tax havens in Jersey are nectar.
In Jersey are nectar. I present any lady whose conduct is shady, all smacking of doubtful propriety.
Doubtful propriety.
When virtue would quash her, I take and whitewash her and launch her in first-rate society.
First-rate society.
I recommend acres of clumsy dressmakers, their feet and their finishing touches.
Their finishing touches.
A sum in addition they pay for permission to say that they make for a duchess.
They make for the duchess. I visit spin doctors and also weight watchers. I once met a duchess there writing.
A duchess there writing.
Her memoirs revealing a toe-sucking feeling.
Escapades too exciting. Escapades too exciting.
I sit by selection upon the direction of Camelot PLC Lottery.
PLC Lottery.
Its income is waning, but I'm still obtaining an increase that makes life a mockery.
That makes life a mockery. At middle class party, I play at écarté, and I'm by no means a beginner.
She's not a beginner.
To one of my station, the remuneration, 5 guineas a night and my dinner.
A pint with her dinner.
I write letters blatant on medicine's patent, and use any others you mustn't.
Believe me, you mustn't.
And vow my complexion derives its perfection from somebody's soap, which it doesn't.
It certainly doesn't. We are ready as witness to anyone's fitness to fill any place or preferment.
A place or preferment? We're often in waiting at junket or fainting, and sometimes attend an interment.
We enjoy an interment.
In short, if you kindle the spark of a swing, your symbols into your clutches, into your clutches. Or hoodwink a debtor, you cannot do better than trot out a duke. Or a duchess.
A duke.
Or a duchess.
So this is the position. Deadlock.
We're both married, and it seems that one of us is the king of Barataria and a bigamist because he was married to Casilda as a child.
And all we want is our husbands back.
Kings or not.
Meanwhile, Casilda, Queen of Barataria, apparently married to one of the gondoliers, is in love with Lewis.
The only person who can sort out this mess is Inez, Lewis's mother. She was responsible for the baby prince, and she's now languishing in a torture chamber, collecting her thoughts. Who is the new king of Barataria? We wait with bated breath.
Here is a case of precedented, here a king, a queen, a son. Ever since marriage was first invented, never was known a case so hard.
I may myself have been bisected by a profound catastrophe.
Through a calamity unexpected, I'm divisible into three.
I may myself have been bisected.
I am divisible into three. Through a calamity, I am divisible into three.
Attention!
News we seek, this moment mentioned.
To us the ring!
This
foster mother.
See the king.
Punish my brother.
See for the stage. See for the stage.
The royal prince was by the king entrusted to my fond care. I grew old and crusted, and traitors came to steal his son reputed. My own small boy I deftly substituted. The villains fell into the trap completely. I hid the prince away, still sleeping sweetly. I caught him son with pardonable slyness. His name, Louis. Behold his royal highness.
Thank you.
Next week's highlight from the proms is a performance of Beethoven's Pastoral Symphony by the National Orchestra of Wales. That's next Thursday evening at 10 to 11 here on BBC One.